Ladies and gentlemen, most welcome. We have the experience that the month of June is the calling power of an organization like SID, but any organization which is organizing extracurricular activities is at proof. But the more I appreciate June and the end of the academic year, other obligations, passing examinations, already making a schedule for traveling back home makes it sometimes rather difficult to attend this kind of meetings. But the more we appreciate your presence, and your presence is indeed rightly justified by the speakers we can present to you tonight and by the series as a whole. First of all, I have to welcome Professor Joris Voorhoeven. And Professor Voorhoeven, well known to most of you, a strong record not only in Dutch politics as leader of the Liberal Party, but also in development, international cooperation. And I may remind you about his thesis, about 35 years ago, about the history, at that time already, the history, the coming of age already 35 years ago of the Dutch international cooperation. And since then, he was one of the pillars, I may say so, one of the pillars of that broad consensus coalition for international cooperation, a multi-party approach in a certain sense, which brought the Netherlands to, if you may believe, the Center for Global Development to this most prominent position worldwide, which the Netherlands over the last few years has achieved. A consensus and a broader approach, which in a certain sense is under pressure nowadays and which makes, his stand, and the stand of a few other people at this moment, courageous. And I want to abuse this rostrum to thank Professor Voorhoeven, for example, for his excellent article yesterday in the Daily Trouw, in which he very clearly pointed out that in the 21st century, and especially during this financial crisis, it is the worst answer to skip our broad obligations and commitments to international cooperation. Thanks a lot for this contribution, Professor Voorhoeven. Thanks a lot for your thinking. You are, by the way, also a member of that new movement of the World Connectors. And thanks for your willingness to be the co-chair, to be the co-speaker tonight. And then Professor Cleland. Not also a very strong, a very famous name. I should have mentioned that Professor Voorhoeven also has another quality, because he is also chairman of the partner of SID in this respect of the World Foundation for the World Population, the Population Foundation, and this is makes underscores the partnership between our two three organizations, World Population Foundation, ISS, and SID. And I may use of the occasion as well to welcome the new director of the successor of Frans Baneke Frans Baneke for the at the World Population Foundation in the next period, and we hope we expect the same fruitful cooperation as in the past. Professor Cleland, you are familiar with The Hague. The Hague is familiar with you. You've worked here for a number of years at the International Statistics Institute. But that you really, your independent view on population issues is known, your independent views also, your appreciation, your valuation, better to say, of the Cairo conference, and this series was organized because of the 15 years after Cairo. Well, you have published and you had your very strong own opinions, which we value as well highly in this issue. And therefore, the new angle, so to say, for this series is that the trend towards lower fertility and low mortality, as we have seen also in the two previous sessions, has been markedly uneven, with the result that the current population characteristics of nations have probably never been so diverse. Fertility ranges from a little over one birth per woman to over 7 births, and life expectancy from 40 till 80 years. You remember still the demographic transition lecture 2 months ago. Fertility and mortality levels and trends together with migration determine age structure, which in turn has profound economic prospects, implications for economic prospects and welfare. And also the whole issue of the aging population in countries like India, for example, certain parts of Latin America, we should face as well. And this presentation tonight will focus on the opportunities and challenges posed by population dynamics in low and middle income countries. It will be argued also that the benign neglect of the past 15 years of population issues in poor countries, particularly those in Africa, has to end. And well, I wish you a very interesting evening, and I'm assured that with the contributions of both the speakers, and to start with Professor Cleland, will be worthwhile to attend at a nice evening here at the Institute of Social Studies. Professor Cleland, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. It is a bit like coming home. I did live in The Hague for 2 years, and indeed I was external examiner of the ISS. So it's a double pleasure to be invited here to talk on this series of population development, which has been sadly absent from the international discourse, really ever since Cairo, and to return to a city that I lived in for 2 years. I was introduced as a person with very strong and individual and independent views. I think I'm meek and mild. I just want to tell you the truth. The theme tonight is population and generation. So I'm going to concentrate on age structure as countries move from high mortality to high fertility down to low mortality and low fertility, because it is the key to understanding the huge importance of population trends for social and economic development. Let's start with the big picture. Here's life expectancy since 1950. Huge triumph of mankind over disease, great testimony to biomedical science. The thing you ought to point out, to note, is that Africa has lagged behind. 50 years ago, it was quite close in terms of life expectancy with the other developing regions. Now it's way behind. And that is not just due to AIDS. There's evidence also that non-AIDS death rates actually increased in the 90s. The 90s was a very bad decade for Africa with negative economic growth. Once mortalities decline, fertility decline is sooner or later inevitable. And this is what's happened to fertility since 1950 up to the beginning of this century. Europe down the bottom there with fertility currently at about 1.5 births per woman, well below the two-child mark that guarantees in the long-term stability of population size. Asia and Latin America, a huge decrease in fertility from about 6 births per woman down to a little under 3 today and still declining. So the fertility transition is well on track in most of Asia and most of Latin America. But again, Africa stands out way above the other regions with high fertility, still on average across the whole region of 5 births per woman. And the worrying feature is that it hasn't changed much in the last decade.